Welcome back to the Career Gaming, brought to you by The Career Zoo. We're playing Mario Kart again. My name's Sean.
I'm Callie.
And we are joined by
Rachel.
And first off, which characters are you guys?
I'm Rosalina, just because she's, I don't know a lot about her character. She just wears blue, and you know, I'm more into that than Princess Toadstool in the pink. So.
And you got her on a Vespa?
Yes. Yeah. She's Italian in my fantasy.
I'm Toadette, because she's cute, and it looks like she's got a helmet, and I think I'm going to need it.
Well, why don't you guys get going with the next race? And we'll dive into Rachel. Can you tell us a little bit about what you do?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm the marketing and research manager at a company called TheCareerZoo. Mm-hmm. We actually make, it's called clearboarding. It's a polycarbonate window and door covering for fake and abandoned buildings, and it's the best alternative to plywood, quite frankly. So I work a lot on what getting the word out and actually teaching people about what this product is.
Wait, can you tell me what's so bad about plywood?
So plywood, when you are driving down the street and you see a plywood boarded building, you automatically know, hey, this place is empty.
Oh.
And part of the research in my job is working with colleges and universities and actually professionals who dig into trends and things like that. And any community that has a boarded building, it drastically impacts the home values up to a mile away by like $8,000 to $10,000 per home. Crime in the area of plywood boarded buildings is higher, drastically higher, and it costs a lot more for first responders, for police, fire, because an empty building is more likely to have a fire because people are squatting there, trying to keep warm, or it attracts arsonists. So, plywood's terrible for communities, and a lot of people don't think about it.
Okay,
so who's like, where does your business come from? If it is an abandoned building?
So, somebody owns the abandoned building, generally speaking. It's usually a bank at that point in time. It's probably been foreclosed on.
Mm-hmm.
And banks are responsible for foreclosed homes to actually keep them up. And our company was founded by Rachel Kerstetter, who started Safeguard, who actually keeps properties up for mortgage servicers. And he just decided there had to be a better way, and they came up with the idea of polycarbonate. So we work a lot with like towns, cities, banks, but even you know some building owners that they own a vacant property that they are either trying to sell or trying to get tenants in, trying to rent spaces.
So can you tell us a little bit about like what your college background was that led you to this?
Yeah, so I never would have imagined when I was in college that this is what I would be doing. My degree is in communications, specifically concentrating in PR, but I also minored in business with a marketing concentration.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was in college, I didn't know what I wanted to do, so I started looking for internships in the PR field, and I ended up interning at an agency downtown here called Fargo Martin, and I got to learn about all different things, about business consumer, nonprofit, higher education, tourism, so it was cool to get into a lot of different things, and I decided that I liked the variety and the difference in every day, and so I pursued an agency job right after school. I actually worked at a marketing agency for 6 years before starting at TheCareerZoo a few months ago.
You had a bunch of mushrooms there at the end. You're on a roll, but I don't know.
I'm still in seven. My computer is beating me.
I'm the Sean of this game.
It feels pretty good, doesn't it?
A little bit. This never happens to me. I just want you to know I'm not good at this usually.
Well, I'm happy to help. I'm terrible.
So maybe this is for me. Maybe I like the Switch. I don't know.
No, we have to go out and buy one. So it is. Could you tell us a little bit about the about like what drew you to the like the philanthropy? That's the correct word. Yeah, I went to college. Everybody, don't worry.
It's okay. Words are hard.
Yeah.
So when I was working at the marketing agency, I liked what I did. I liked my clients, great people. But we were really product focused and trying to help their sales, which is a wonderful thing to do. And yeah, I still do that where I am, but there's elements of being more involved and doing more. And one of the things that I love about my current job is we have an advocacy arm that helps. I'm really well.
I don't think you die, though.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You can drive.
I don't know where I am. Our advocacy arm really helps kind of spread the word about how to control blight in communities caused by these properties that cause the arms. Because they, you know, they're dead, basically, mm-hmm. and they're in bad shape, and they're, you know, negatively impacting everything around them. So, they create them. That's the name. So I love working with our advocacy arm because we are not only getting the word out, but we're helping communities write legislation that will actually help them improve the lives of people who live there, improve the economy of where they live. So it's nice to be a part of that, and there's that element of saving the world, and then by what we do and what we're advocating for, we're helping helping communities set themselves up to have affordable housing as well.
Could you take us through like what a typical day is? So also, you're up to third.
Cool. yeah, so every day is a little bit different, which is kind of nice, but I spend a lot of my mornings going through news and looking to see what's happening in the world of, you know, community blight and trying to remediate vacant abandoned properties that have become zombies. So I spend a lot of time there, and then I'm reaching out to the people who are writing about it just to give them more resources to share, because, you know, we've got all this research. Mm-hmm. But then I'm also helping our sales team help direct them to places and people that they may not have made contact with yet. And then I do a lot with our digital marketing. So I spend a lot of my day in our marketing automation system, working through our email system as well as with our digital ads and website traffic, and seeing where people are coming from, what they're looking for, and how we can help them more.
So what type of digital ads are you guys doing? Because it doesn't necessarily seem like you're the businesses are banks or whoever owns the foreclosed.
Yeah, so we're doing a lot of before and after.
Yeah.
Being able to actually show and sharing some statistics and things like that. And we're targeting the people who are building owners. And one of the things that we're trying to focus on right now is helping commercial properties. Mm-hmm. Because there are a lot of empty commercial properties, especially stores like Toys R Us or whatever go out of business. You know, they're losing their copper.
Yeah.
They're losing, you know, their systems, and it's going to take a whole lot to rehab that building, whereas if they can, we call it mothballing, if they can mothball their building and keep it in good shape, then it's a good investment.
Well, that's awesome. Well, make sure to follow us at the Career Zoo. What advice would you give to somebody that's thinking about going into like PR and marketing communication?
You have to like communicating, first of all. If you don't like talking to people, you don't have to like talking to a big group. But if you don't like talking to people, maybe you should look into another career option. But hone your writing. Writing skills are crucial. Content is probably the biggest asset any company has in marketing. Mm-hmm. And most of that content is written in some form or fashion. So writing skills are a must. And then just, you know, practice and anything you can. One of the best pieces of advice I ever got was to write every day. Doesn't matter what, just write something every day. And so to most of us in communications, that ends up being a blog. So, you know, I started with a blog, and it really helped me just practice my writing and communicating skills. So it's a good place to start.
What are you blogging about?
A little bit of everything. So I have type 1 diabetes, and I'm a huge advocate for, you know, raising awareness so that people can get, if they have the symptoms, they can actually get diagnosed sooner rather than later. And then I'm advocating for a cure because diabetes sucks. But I also write about kind of life and being a young professional, a little bit about marriage and relationships, but then in my spare time when I want to be creative, I like to refashion clothing and new furniture, and so I write about that too. So.
If somebody wanted to read that, where would
you? Probably Rachel.com. And that's me on all social media, if you ever want to spend a little time, see some pictures of my dog and cats.
And it's probably Rachel.
Probably
like,
Rachel.
Like, you're not, like, unsure about it.
No, I am absolutely not unsure about it. I'm definitely Rachel, but my handle is probably Rachel.
You're going to get the Rachel handle from, like, Rachel Ray and all that?
No. Hence the word probably had to be from. I'm sure Rachel.com is a whole different thing.
Wow, you guys are doing great this time.
I'm trying not to get hit by a bus.
It's very nerve-wracking, right?
Not something I normally have to do.
Somebody else hit me. It wasn't a bus.
You just, like, hear about all these stories in, like, LA. They just let, like, motorcycles go in the middle of traffic. And I feel like that's exactly what this level is.
But we're going the wrong way. This is weird.
Can you talk about your, like experiences with social media and how you kind of use them?
Yeah, so I am a self-described social media enthusiast. I love the online world. When I was in school, it was just a new thing. You know, a lot of people didn't know how Facebook pages were brand new. Mm-hmm. And so my first internship ever was actually setting up a Facebook page for a nonprofit organization and helping them operate it. So at that point in time, we were learning as we went. Now a lot of colleges have social media as part of their curriculum, which is excellent. But it's kind of, you know, there's a difference between doing social for yourself and, you know, Snapchatting your friends and writing about your, you know, your day on Facebook than when you're on social media for a company or, you know, nonprofit. So it's a lot of fun to be able to tell stories and not die when you get hit by a bus.
you were talking about your internship.
Yeah.
How did that help you prepare you for your career now?
So I did 3 internships in college. Every single one of them was valuable. Mm-hmm. I got to learn a lot from people who were doing it. And that's actually a really, you know, really, really good thing is when you're in school, they're teaching you strategy, they're teaching you processes, ways to kind of think about things, mm-hmm. but they're not teaching you how to actually do the stuff, the tactical work that you'll be doing in an entry-level company. So that's where the internships come in. They actually teach you how to build a media list if you're going into PR, how to operate a social media channel, how to write, you know, short snippets for Twitter. Mm-hmm. At the time it was 140 characters, now you've got so many more, but that sort of thing. So it's internships are very valuable, I think, even if they don't pay you sometimes.
Yeah, yeah. So. How did you go about getting, like, your first internship? Is it just knowing the right people, or is it, like, really showing your worth before you can actually show your worth?
I think it's a combination of talking to the right people, but also being able to really research who's doing what. My first internship I found through a professor, mm-hmm. who knew the woman who was hiring.
Mm-hmm.
My second internship I found all by myself. I was searching and I said, I want to intern an agency to figure out what I want to do with my life, like I mentioned, and I found the internship and I applied. It was an hour and a half drive.
Oh, wow.
3 days a week to this internship in college, but it was really, really worth it to be able to do it. So I think that there's that combination of talking to people and knowing the right people, as well as just doing the research, and, you know, everything's online now. It's a lot easier to find who's looking for what.
Could you kind of explain the differences between working for an agency and kind of working for a nonprofit business?
Yeah. So agencies are, you're working for a lot of companies. Sorry, it's really hard to talk and not run into the wall. So in agencies, it takes a specific attitude. You can burn out really quickly because you're doing a lot of different things very quickly. You're working for a lot of different companies. You have to learn a lot. So I think it's a really great place to do an internship, even if you ultimately don't want to work at an agency. And it's also a really good place to get started. I worked in an agency for 6.5 years. It was a great learning experience. It's a ton of experience very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Things that you don't necessarily get in an entry-level position sometimes.
Yeah.
But one of the things that you have to keep in mind is you don't have the full picture when you're in an agency working for clients. You don't necessarily know all of the strategies. Sometimes it's, hey, the client said they want this, mm-hmm. so we gotta do it. Whereas at a nonprofit specifically, you not only know the strategy, you're probably doing everything. Most nonprofits have issues with budgets and, you know, not having the resources, so everybody's kind of a jack of all trades.
Mm-hmm.
At a corporation like where I am, even though we're a small company, we're doing a lot, We have a little bit more in the way of resources, and I am able to, like, hire an agency.
Yeah.
But I get to be fully invested because I know the strategy. I know what I'm doing. I get to be part of the decision-making process. And then I have one company to think about, one company to be behind, as opposed to trying to, you know, split my focus.
Yeah, I love watching
you. We're staring with our heads.
This is how I drive.
Rachel, I know you're really big in what sort of advice is, why do you think it's so important for young people to get networking and be part of a professional organization?
I think networking is super important, especially for people who are communicating every day. So PRSA is the Public Relations Society of America. It's the professional organization for public relations and communications professionals. And most careers have a professional association. I think it's really important to be involved because, especially at a small company where I am, or even an agency where, at the point where I was, I didn't really have a PR person who had more experience than me there, but I needed to be able to get advice. And so the people of PRSA are the advice givers. I got set up with their mentorship program, and I have some excellent mentors through that who have kind of helped me when I've had a stumbling block in my career or a challenge that I needed some outside advice for. It's a good place to also get connected with people who can help you find a job, an internship, or even just, you know, a volunteer opportunity to get more experience.
Oh, you guys were really close there at the end. What advice would you give to somebody going into PR?
Learn as much as you can. Always, you know, always be learning something. Be braiding, like I said. But also, you know, get to know the people who are doing what you want to do,
mm-hmm.
and ask them questions, because they are more than likely going to love to answer your questions and tell you everything about their jobs in life.
Well, that's awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us
me.
For playing Mario Kart. Make sure to follow at the Career Zoo. We can be found on most social channels. Thank you so much. We'll be right back with another live stream.